daydreamed before about what it'd be like to have a special ability that other organisms can do. For example, to be able to fly like a peregrine falcon, or to be able to walk up walls without any gear, like a Texas bandit gecko. But if I told you I really wish I could have a special ability of a plant, you'd probably be confused. What can a plant do that's so amazing? There's a lot of cool things about plants, actually, but in particular, I really wish I could do photosynthesis. And it's not just plants that can do this process. Some protists and some bacteria can too, for example. But plants will be our main focus for this video clip. Animals and amoebas have missed out on this ability, but we benefit from it greatly, as this process also produces oxygen, a gas that we need. Plants in general are major producers, making them indispensable in food webs. Many of our medications and foods come from plants. We need plants. So understanding the nature of the process that plants use to make their own food is paramount. So when I say make their own food, I'm talking about making the sugar that they need, specifically glucose. You need glucose too, but you get it from what you eat. Plants, however, get to make their own glucose in photosynthesis. Here is the balanced overall equation for photosynthesis, similar to what you'll find in many introductory biology textbooks. As you will notice, it has some similarities to aerobic cellular respiration. Recall that cellular respiration is used to make ATP, which is an energy currency, and it's done by plants as well as animals and a lot of other organisms too. You can see how these reactants, inputs, of photosynthesis are included in the products, outputs, in cellular respiration, and the products, outputs, of photosynthesis are included in the reactants, inputs, of cellular respiration. Well, this doesn't mean that they're simply reversed. It is interesting to see what they have in common. So while both plants and animals need glucose for cellular respiration, plants don't have to be in search of glucose because they make it. Plants have adaptations to carry out photosynthesis in a variety of environments. One thing plants have to do is capture light. Plants can use light-capturing molecules called pigments. Recall that visible light has different wavelengths, and those different wavelengths of light have different colors. If you've ever played with a prism before, you can see how light can be separated into a rainbow of colors due to different wavelengths. So a pigment that plants commonly use to capture light is called chlorophyll. Chlorophyll does a great job at absorbing red and blue light, but not so much green light. Chlorophyll reflects green light, resulting in many plants appearing green to our eyes. There are pigments besides chlorophyll that work with different wavelengths of light, and this can explain why green is not the only color you see in plants. Chlorophyll is a pigment that can be found in the chloroplast of plant cells. There are two major processes that occur in the chloroplast that, together, make up photosynthesis. They are the light-dependent reactions and the light-independent reactions. The light-independent reactions can also be called the Kelvin cycle, or even, less commonly, the dark reaction. Sounds intriguing. We're going to talk about both of these briefly, and please remember, like most of our videos, this is pretty general. We've got some further reading links in the video description where you can explore a lot more detail. So, light-dependent reactions happen in the thylakoids, little compartments in the chloroplast that contain pigment. A collective stack would be a granum, multiple stacks would be grana. In the light-dependent reactions, light is captured, and water, which is a reactant in the photosynthesis equation, is split. That means if you think of the chemical formula for water, which is H2O, it is split so you get electrons, protons, and oxygen. So oxygen is also a product of the light-dependent reactions. The light-dependent reactions also produce ATP and NADPH, which we'll get to in a little bit. Both the ATP and the NADPH will be needed for the next process, the light-independent reactions, also known as the Kelvin cycle, or dark reaction. The name is a bit misleading. While yes, the process isn't directly capturing light, it doesn't require darkness either. And again, it will need items from the light-dependent reactions, like the ATP and NADPH. The light-independent reactions still happen in the chloroplast, but specifically, the light-independent reactions happen in the stroma. The stroma is a fluid outside of the thylakoids. In the light-independent reactions, or Kelvin cycle, carbon dioxide enters. It is taken in through pores that are often, but not always, on the bottom of leaves, and those pores are called stomata. Plants have the ability to open and close their stomata. The carbon dioxide gas enters the stomata and will be fixed. By fixed, I mean that with the additional help of a major enzyme, the inorganic carbon dioxide is changed to a more usable form. The ATP from the light-dependent reactions will act as an energy currency for the Kelvin cycle. The NADPH that had come from the light-dependent reactions will supply reducing power. By that, I mean that it helps add high-energy electrons to this process. So, in a very complex series of pathways, the fixed carbon dioxide, ATP, and NADPH are used to make a product that, ultimately, can be converted into glucose, a sugar. Whew. So let's take a look at this equation. Last time, I promise. So we have here the circled items. These were from the light-dependent reactions. Now, notice these other items, the carbon dioxide on the reactant side and the glucose on the product side. Those are from the Kelvin cycle. Remember, there is so much more detail to explore in this amazing process. You can learn about the photosystems that are in light-dependent reactions, or detail of all the steps in the Kelvin cycle and how ATP and NADPH will be converted to ADP and NADP+, which can then be used again by the light-dependent reactions. But before we end our short video, we do want to mention that plants have some amazing adaptations that can help them perform photosynthesis efficiently in very different environments. Many of these adaptations can involve the diversity of leaf shapes, coverings, and pigments. This is definitely worthy of a completely separate video topic, but just to give a neat example of an adaptation involving photosynthesis, consider the cactus. Cacti have a potential problem. They often live in a hot desert, and so if they open their stomata during the hot day to get their carbon dioxide, they can easily lose more water than would be ideal. The precious water can escape through the stomata if the stomata are open, and that will happen at a faster rate in the hot desert sun. But cacti, and some other plants too, can do something called CAM photosynthesis. In CAM photosynthesis, plants can open their stomata at night when it's not so hot, and they can capture carbon dioxide and chemically store it. They can then use this carbon dioxide the next day when the sun is shining and yet have their stomata closed. This allows them to avoid having to open their stomata in the heat of the day. Well, that's it for the Amoeba Sisters, and we remind you to stay curious.